my co-chair to take the, introduce the next two speakers and to go ahead with the program.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Biswas. It's my pleasure to welcome the next speaker, Dr. Srini Kaveri. He has received his veterinary medical degrees for bachelor's and post-graduation from India. He did his PhD at the Pasteur Institute, Paris. Later on, pursued his research as a postdoctoral fellow in the University of California, San Diego. He joined the CNRC, that's the National Center for Scientific Research, in 1990, where he has been leading the team affiliated to INSERM and Sorbonne University, Paris. His interests include immunopathology, immunotherapy, and a special focus on autoimmune diseases and inflammatory diseases. And from 2015, Dr. Kaveri represents the French CNRS as a director of New Delhi Bureau at the French Embassy. And today he is going to talk to us about immunoglobulins functions and applications. Those who have been PhD students in the 70s would realize that at that point of time, when anybody was asked, do you know immunology, the only topic that used to be very popularly dealt with is immunoglobulins and antibodies. And immunoglobulins itself has made a special niche for itself with the discovery of the structure of antibodies, with the Nobel Prize being awarded to Edelman and Porter in 1972. Today, we will hear more about the immunoglobulins as its function and its applications in immunology and other diseases. We welcome Dr. Srini Kaveri to deliver his talk. Please, Dr. Srini.
Thank you very much, Padma.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Nice to see you, sir. Very much. We're looking forward to your talk.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much. And it's a pleasure. I don't know. We normally people would have been, you know, enjoying some movies or going to park or some parties on a Saturday evening. But, you know, Chandra, you have made it so difficult for them to sit and listen to all these immunology talks. But the fact that they're all sitting and enjoying these talks means this is a very successful operation. Thank you very much. Congratulations, Chandra. And thank you, Padma, once again. And thanks, Dr. Jyotirmay Basu. If I may ask Dr. Padma, if you don't mind, you can mute now so that there is no noise. And I will share my screen. And just give me one. Somebody has to say that it's working. That's all I need. I need to give me a... Is it working, Chandra? Yeah?
It's working.
Good. Yeah, first of all, once again, thank you very much for the organizers, Chandrasekhar and Padma and Jyotirmay Biswas for introducing me and giving me this opportunity. Before I start, I would also like to thank my colleagues. This is a photo taken some time back in the heart of Paris, and the garden that you see is called Jardin du Luxembourg, right in the heart of Paris. And if you walk about 200 meters that way, straight ahead, you will be in Notre Dame de Paris. And if you walk on the right side, you will be walking near Pantheon, which is a very, very beautiful monument. And the building that you're seeing is the Senate building. And these people are my colleagues. Some of them are fellow scientists and others are students. I'll introduce them. And sometimes they are also in the lab. And when they're in the lab, they're quite effective. They're not always in the park. And I would also like to thank many of my clinician colleagues and my collaborators. I ask many questions that are clinical, have a lot of clinical orientation. Therefore, I need clinicians' help quite a bit. And so I'd like to thank them in Paris and elsewhere. And I have quite a few collaborations a little bit around the world. And in India with Nagraj, Balaji, D. N. Rao in Indians of Science, and Negi, a good friend of Chandra's and probably a friend of quite a few people, immunologists in India, Veer Singh Negi in Pondicherry, and Indian Institute of Hematology, Immunohematology, INSERM lab, ICMR lab in Bombay and other places. What has been very interesting over the last two talks is that my whatever I'm going to say has been made very easy by the two elegant talks, one by Chandra, overview of the immune system, and by Deepankar, who gave a beautiful overview of the cells that are involved. So my job becomes extremely easy. And so the first part of my introductory part of my lecture, I will go a bit fast because you have already listened to that in a much more elegant manner than I can present. So as you're sitting here, even on a Saturday evening at your home, I guess you don't have your masks. So you are exposed to certain number of pathogens. Most of what I'm going to say has already been covered by Chandrasekhar and by Deepankar. And therefore, so please bear with me. This is a bit repetitive, but I need to show this to go on with my talk. So these organisms, the pathogens, the bacteria, virus, fungus, etc., they come equipped with what we call as danger-associated molecular patterns or pathogen-associated molecular patterns. These are repetitive biochemical units, entities on the pathogens. And when they enter the body, the sentinels or the patrolling cells, Deepankar mentioned it very beautifully, the dendritic cells, among others, there are many other antigen-presenting cells. These patrolling or sentinels or the police, they immediately recognize the pathogenic patterns, pathogen-associated patterns, through what we call as pathogen-recognizing receptors or TAR-like receptors. The moment they are recognized, the innate immune system is triggered. We already heard about the innate immune system. In addition to all the first line of defense, the innate immune cells, they handle these pathogens and get rid of these pathogens. If the pathogen load is more, if there is a more virulent pathogen that's entering into the system, and if the innate immune system cannot completely cope up, then the adaptive immune system kicks in. In the adaptive immune system, as we already heard, the antigen-presenting cells like macrophages or dendritic cells, they present the antigen. In this case, I have represented the antigen as a little triangular motif from one of the pathogens. And this pathogen, when it is chopped and cut into pieces and presented as a peptide, like say a triangle here, to the T cell receptor, that initiates the activation of the T cells. This is called signal number one, as Deepankar already mentioned. But that's not enough. You need a cognate interaction. You need co-stimulation. And we heard about the co-stimulatory molecules. And that's called signal number two. And when there is an appropriate co-stimulation, the T cells get activated. They start multiplying and they start polarizing, depending on the nature of the pathogen. At the same time, they also provide help through either IL-4 or IL-6 or some other cytokines to the B cells, which are sleeping. These dormant B cells are then now triggered to become plasma cells, and the plasma cells secrete antibodies. Antibodies, unlike the components of the innate immune system, are more specific. They're specific for what? They're specific for the pathogen, which has, let us say, already entered into the target organ, let's say the lungs. The antibodies recognize the pathogen in the lungs, and the moment the antibodies through its antigen combining site, that is the variable region, when they recognize the pathogen, a series of interactions or a cascade of events begin. The variable regions bind to the pathogen, and the constant portion or the Fc portion of the immunoglobulin binds or interacts with the Fc receptors that are present on the macrophages, which are now present or which have migrated to the site of action. Macrophages express the Fc receptors, and once the Fc receptors are engaged, macrophages start secreting some obnoxious molecules like cytokines, pro-inflammatory molecules, and other substances. The idea here is to get rid of the pathogen, to remove the pathogen from the system. And if this is not good enough, this already sets in an inflammation, because as I told you, there are pro-inflammatory cytokines that are secreted. But this inflammation is good. You need this inflammation. You don't even want to stop this inflammation. This inflammation is associated a little bit with fever and other symptoms, but you don't want to stop that. If this is not good enough to get rid of the pathogen, the macrophages also express what is called complement receptors.
Dr. Kaveri, I think you have to little come closer to the microphone. I think people are saying they're unable to hear you.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Is it okay now? Is it better?
Yeah, I think it's fine. Yeah.
I hope. I mean, if there's a problem with the sound, then please do tell me. Okay, Chandra. Yeah, thanks.
Sure.
Oh, I'm so sorry. But okay, good. So the complement receptors, they get activated, they are engaged. The whole complement cascade event is engaged. You will hear a lot about the complement from Arvind next talk. Arvind Sahu will talk about that. But the idea of engaging the complement cascade is to drill the hole on your pathogen by forming the membrane attack complex. Arvind will describe the entire biochemical events that are involved in the complement activation. The point here is, through the activation of complement, you destroy the pathogen, and that's very effective, because if there are children that are born with a defect in the complement components, they cannot eliminate the pathogen as effectively. But imagine a situation where all this phenomenon is not sufficient to remove the pathogen, and you need some extra help, and that help comes from the T cells. And the T cells now, they become polarized, meaning the T cells that were Th naive, meaning they were not polarized to any particular subtype, under the influence of a certain cytokines, they are now polarized towards either Th1, and if there is an excess of Th1, which is pro-inflammatory, they are controlled by Th2. And more recently, we have identified another bunch of cells called Th17 cells, which are also potent, pro-inflammatory, but equally effective against the pathogens. And to control the excessive Th17 cells, we have another bunch of cells, which is a negative feedback. And to control these, there is a bunch of cells called regulatory T cells. You heard about them, CD4 positive, CD25 positive, FOXP3 positive cells. And these regulatory T cells, also called Tregs, they control the Th17 cells. The point here is the pro-inflammatory cytokines, T cells like Th1 or Th17, they reactivate the macrophages, and the macrophages then start producing more obnoxious molecules like nitric oxide, metalloproteases, TNF-alpha or other cytokines. And the objective here is to ensure that the pathogen is eliminated. And pathogen is eliminated. Incidentally, the clearance of the pathogen works to perfection. This is an overview of the immune system, but you already knew about it by the two earlier talks, but maybe you already knew about it. As Deepankar also mentioned, the immune system, when it behaves perfectly well, it's all fine. You remove the pathogens, it's good. But unfortunately, there are some kids that are born without a particular component of the immune system. A defect or a lack of any of these components of the immune system results in immunodeficiency. And as Deepankar mentioned, there are some examples of baby bubble boy, he called it, and in French, they're called baby bulle. And here I'm showing the picture of one particular baby with Professor Alain Fischer, whose work is absolutely fantastic, because for the first time, he demonstrated that it is possible to insert or to correct the gene that is necessary or that can correct the immunodeficiency. In other words, these kids who did not have any option, these kids who did not have any therapeutic option, now, thanks to the work of Professor Alain Fischer in Hôpital Necker, not too far from where I work, and Alain Fischer showed that it is possible to introduce a gene, so-called gene therapy. Although there are still some obstacles, one day this will become a reality and these children can live normally. So this is one form of a deviation of the immune system where a component of the immune system is missing, and therefore they're immunodeficient, they're X-linked. Or, as we already heard, immune system can be overactive, and this is, as you all know, allergy, and that's not good either. But there are some situations where there is no infection, but still the immune system gets activated, and it gets activated against your own pancreas, the same potent pro-inflammatory either cytokines or the T cells. They start aggressing your own pancreas, then you end up with diabetes, the autoimmune form of diabetes. And there are many other conditions where when the immune system fails to recognize, fails to distinguish what is self and what is non-self. We just heard from Deepankar or between the self and non-self recognition, the tolerance. If there is a break in tolerance and the T cells or the B cells or the antibodies start recognizing your own tissue, then you end up with autoimmunity. I know that you knew this, all this, but I wanted to introduce one particular component that I'm going to discuss a bit more, and that is about antibodies. And my story starts long back. My story starts almost 120 years ago, when for the first time, Emil von Behring and Kitasato, they identify that if you take a toxin and keep administrating, you inactivate that and you administer it to a lab animal like guinea pigs or rabbits, over a period of time, in the serum of the animals that are injected, there is a substance and that is able to neutralize the toxin. This discovery of passive administration of the antitoxin to cure or to treat patients with diphtheria became a very important finding. And soon they discovered that the substance within the plasma or serum of the animals that got repeated injections, they had a substance called antibodies. This is a monumental work, and Nobel Prize went. First ever Nobel Prize in medicine went to von Behring for the discovery of antibodies. Probably a century or even much later, this work will be remembered. And it is probably one of the most impactful works in immunology. And currently, as we are going through vaccination against corona, you know how important is this phenomenon. But then vaccination was discovered much earlier by Jenner and by Louis Pasteur. You all know that. As soon as the antibodies were understood or discovered that you can prepare an antibody against a particular toxin, say in this case, diphtheria, soon, just across in France, Emile Roux, he prepared large quantities of anti-diphtheria antibodies in anti-diphtheria serum actually, and he could successfully treat 300 children in Lyon and in Paris and entire France. And he could cure, I mean, he could save these children who were absolutely going to die. So this work became very fascinating, very interesting. And they knew that there is a magic bullet in this particular ampoule. This ampoule containing the anti-diphtheria antibodies became the hot topic of biochemists, by immunologists, by clinicians, by everyone. This became the central topic of discoveries and very interesting work. They studied the functional aspects, the structure and the binding properties of this substance or these antibodies, and more importantly, the exploitation of the functions, I mean, therapeutic aspects of these antibodies became very, very important. The story of the next 40 years, I'm going to go fast forward. So I'll make it very fast because of shortage of time. But if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to discuss with you. The next 40 years and several Nobel Prizes were won during this period. Right in Paris, right in Pasteur Institute, Charles Richer, he discovered that upon injection of anti-serum, for example, guinea pig serum, repeatedly to human beings can cause allergy or anaphylactic shock. And he got Nobel Prize in 1913 for that. And Arthur's phenomenon, which is a form of gangrene, once again, because of repeated injection of foreign substances. And he also was recognized as a very important discovery. Important discovery in immunology. Soon, the other side of the river, Karl Leinsteiner in Germany, he described, because we knew now by that time we knew about more about antibodies, and he knew that the A individuals have antibodies to B, B individuals antibodies to A, etc. And the blood group system was discovered. Once again, this is a function of antibodies. Right here in Pasteur Institute, Jules Bordet, he discovered complement, what he called earlier in 1894 as Alexin, is now known as complement. You will hear more about it from Arvind Sahu in a few days, few minutes. More structural and binding properties were discovered. John Marakin, a little bit later, understood how to do the electrophoresis, and they knew how to identify the peaks that correspond to gamma globulins. And they started understanding the biochemical properties of these. Heidelberger and Elvin Kabat, they worked out the structural, some of the structural aspects. They knew that by now that these are antibodies, are actually a form of proteins called gamma globulins, and they're heterogeneous. They have varied structures of antibody combining sites, and therefore they can recognize a large panel of different antigens, but they're specific. Once an antibody is formed against a particular antigen, that particular antibody is highly specific. Meanwhile, Linus Pauling, who had a bad habit of going to Stockholm to get more than one Nobel Prize, he proposed the theory of lock and key, where for the first time, the specificity of antigen-antibody reaction was described in a very elegant manner. And soon we started understanding more about the therapeutic properties, meaning you now know that if there is a pathogen, you can keep on injecting a lab animal. You inactivate that, you keep on injecting, you can get anti-serum. Robert Debré, Charles Nicolle, Ernest Conseil, all these French doctors, they purified antibodies against diphtheria, tetanus, I mean, Clostridium diphtheria, tetanus, botulinum, many, many bacteria, Shigella, and several pathogens. So they had full range of anti-serum for passive immunotherapy. Passive immunotherapy became the hot topic, or the only option, therapeutic option to treat infectious diseases, because by then we did not have, at that time, we did not have antibiotics, we did not have any other substance to treat the infectious diseases. But then the bad news came. The bad news came in the form of World War II, when soldiers were dying not just on the battlefront, they were also dying in the hospitals. They were dying because of infections they had picked up during the war, or they had picked up other complications like hemodynamic complications because of heavy blood loss. By then, a lot of other improvements, technological improvements were made, and the President of the United States of America commissioned a certain Edwin Kahn to go in for mega scale purification of plasma proteins. By then, Edwin Kahn had standardized perfectly how to purify all these different fractions from your plasma. So when you order next time from either Sigma or other chemicals, look up for albumin. When you order albumin, it's always called fraction 5, and it's always called Kahn's fraction 5, and that's albumin. But then there's another important component here of plasma, and that is antibodies. Now we had purified antibodies in our hand. Just about that time, Dr. Colonel Ogden Bruton had returned from Europe after fighting the Second World War, and he was practicing pediatrics in the East Coast. And one day he gets this patient repeatedly. His name was Joseph Haltner. Joseph Haltner Jr. had recurrent pneumonia, recurrent sinusitis, recurrent rhinitis. And Bruton didn't understand why this boy has recurrent infections. And despite giving the available antibiotics, the boy was not responding fully well. And so then he had this brilliant idea of trying to see, is there any defect with his immune system? Can we check at his immune profile? And it is then that he subjected, compared to a healthy individual, he subjected Joseph's blood or plasma for electrophoresis. And he saw that this boy did not have the peak that corresponded to gamma globulins. He knew that there was a problem with this boy. This boy did not have gamma globulins. He was immunodeficient. And you heard about immunodeficiency quite a bit earlier. What Colonel Bruton did was to get the immunoglobulins, which were now available, and he gave them intramuscularly to this boy, and the boy started kicking around in perfect health in a matter of a few days. That means we understood two things now. First, just a small parenthesis. Meanwhile, Rodney Porter and Edelman, Padma mentioned about it. They dissected the structure of these antibodies, immunoglobulins, heavy chains, light chains, the disulfide bridges, and all that structural details were dissected, and these people got Nobel in 1972. So these antibody preparations were given intramuscularly, I told you, and the intramuscular route was painful. That was often causing some reactions and abscess and many complications. So Charles Janeway Sr., when I say Charles Janeway Sr., please know that there is a junior also. And Sr., he himself was a clinician, and with the help of William Berenberg, they treated immunoglobulins, which were administered until now only by intramuscular route. He treated them with pepsin and acid and rendered this preparation, which was given by intramuscular route, as intravenous route. So now we have a new immunoglobulin, meaning at that time, 1950s, we discovered that we can have a preparation of immunoglobulin which can be injected by intravenous route. And this was a major discovery. And this is called IVIG, or intravenous immunoglobulin. Charles Janeway Jr. is son of this senior Charles Janeway, and my respects to Charles Janeway Jr., because if he were alive, probably he would have got Nobel Prize, or he would have shared the Nobel Prize for the discovery of toll-like receptors. So as soon as Colonel Bruton identified that there is a deficiency syndrome called antibody deficiency syndrome, Bruton's X-linked A gamma globulinemia, other clinicians started reporting such antibody deficiencies, and we started soon looking at a whole range of antibody deficiency syndromes. But now the good news was there was a treatment. The treatment was in the form of intravenous immunoglobulin. Now I'll switch over a little bit, and we are almost reaching the 70s now, 70s and 80s. A dramatic mini revolution was going to happen. And that came in the form of monoclonal antibodies. And you heard a little bit about monoclonal antibodies. And I was at the crossroads at that time, whether to pursue with the monoclonal antibodies research or with the use of IVIG. For me, IVIG fascinated, because in the 1980s, just when I came to France, something very, very interesting happened. Paul Imbach, a pediatrician, one day had this patient with idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, or immune thrombocytopenia. In immune thrombocytopenia, you have autoantibodies directed against platelets. These autoantibodies, they opsonize the platelets, and the opsonized platelets, they are phagocytosed by the macrophages, and therefore the number of platelets reduces dramatically in these patients, and they become very susceptible for hemorrhages and other complications because of lack of thrombocytes. Thrombocytes are platelets. In this case, what Paul Imbach wanted to do was that there was a strange coincidence or serendipitous situation. The boy also had hypogammaglobulinemia, meaning he had, unfortunately, another disease, which is hypogammaglobulinemia, which is like antibody deficiencies. So what Paul did was he said, let me at least treat hypogammaglobulinemia of this patient and worry about the platelets a little later, because he had severe infections. So he gave IVIG at 400 milligram per kilogram, but miracle happened. Within 5 days, the number of platelets became normal. This was a shock. This was a very, very unexpected result. Paul Imbach thought that he was treating this boy for hypogammaglobulinemia to substitute the missing antibodies, to bring up the level of the antibodies to normal. Instead, what he observed, in addition to that, he observed that his platelets became normal and that the boy had a perfectly normal platelet levels. This became a very major discovery for autoimmune diseases, because soon other autoimmune diseases also were treated with IVIG. And IVIG entered the clinical scenario in a very, very big manner, because when they saw that ITP could be treated, many clinicians started using it for several other conditions. A whole range of conditions are now treated with IVIG. But like in dermatology, I won't go into the details, but if you have questions, I'll be happy. In neuroimmunological diseases like Guillain-Barré, CIDP, in myasthenia, and in a range of neuroimmunological diseases, including Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, autism, schizophrenia. In other words, neurologists went crazy. I mean, they started using in these conditions. But what is the rationale? I mean, what is the necessary, or what's the logic behind using immunoglobulins in these conditions? Because these immunoglobulins are just normal immunoglobulins. These are normal immunoglobulins purified from the plasma of several thousand healthy people. There is not a monoclonal antibody. It is not specific for anything. These are just normal immunoglobulins that are present in you and me, but from a pool of thousands of healthy people. Why should we use them in all these different conditions? What is the mechanism of action? How does this work? This is what set me in motion. And this is something that I was extremely fascinated. And we knew that there was a need for understanding the mechanism of normal immunoglobulin. For me, this was interesting because we are talking about normal immunoglobulins. The entire half a century of studies had demonstrated various properties that I already mentioned to you, the anaphylactic shock, the blood groups, the complement activity, neutralization of pathogens, all this was known. But now we have these antibodies that are effective in a range of autoimmune diseases. Something else is happening with these antibodies. So this is what I set out, and my journey all the way up to today, from the 80s to today, it is it's a beautiful journey where I'm looking at what is the mechanism of these normal immunoglobulins in this variety of different inflammatory and autoimmune diseases. And although this is a beautiful saga, a nice episodes, it can make a serial like probably Homeland, other exciting series. I'm not going to discuss each of these findings because of shortage of time. I'll give you a snapshot of some of the mechanisms by which how normal immunoglobulins can exert immunoregulatory functions. That is the focus of next few minutes of my talk before I end. So you all know that immunoglobulins or antibodies are made up of two identical heavy chains, identical light chains, and joined together by disulfide bridges. On the variable region, you have a antigen combining site, and through which it binds the antigen or the epitope. And through the Fc portion, you bind the you interact with the Fc receptors. And as you will hear, Arvind will mention about how antibodies also have the regions for combining or interacting with the complement components. In addition, there's something that you want to know is that immunoglobulins are big molecules. They are 150,000 Daltons or 150 kilodaltons. So when you inject these immunoglobulin in another animal, they can be immunogenic. And there are certain antigenic determinants on your antibody, and these are called etiotypes. And you can actually make antibodies against these, and they are called anti-etiotypes. If you have questions, I'll be very happy to answer. So you have etiotypic determinants of antibodies, and you can have antibodies against these determinants. Now, the Fc portion binds to the Fc receptors and exerts certain functions. But what we knew was that most of the autoimmune diseases, inflammation is the hallmark, and IVIG is exerting a beneficial effect. So we and others set out looking for the mechanism of anti-inflammatory activity of IVIG. So one angle that we looked at, how it interacts with complement system, secondly, with the cytokine network, and related to the cytokine network, how IVIG would influence the TH1 versus TH2 balance, and more recently on TH17 and Treg balance, because complement, cytokines, and this particular TH balance is important in inflammation. As you know, if there is an abnormal activity of complement, you will hear more about that, you can have tissue destruction. For example, in Guillain-Barré syndrome or in stroke, the death of the cells, the endothelial cells, is because of the complement membrane attack complex of the complement cascade. And in transplantation, the host, the donor cells can be destroyed by complement activity. And therefore, unusual or abnormal, uncontrolled activity of complement can be extremely dangerous in inflammation or in many other conditions. But there are some feedback mechanisms of controlling excessive activity of complement. You will hear about that in the next talk. What we demonstrated was that IVIG, which is just the normal pooled immunoglobulin, can block the C4B complex, block the C3 convertase, C3A and C3B formation, and more importantly, can deviate the membrane attack complex. So we demonstrated that IVIG can inhibit the complement-mediated tissue damage, one mechanism of anti-inflammatory activity. And we soon discovered that IVIG can selectively downregulate certain pro-inflammatory cytokines, but curiously upregulate, as you can see here, certain anti-inflammatory cytokines, for example, IL-1 receptor antagonist, which is a potent anti-inflammatory cytokine. How this happens is still a mystery, but we are working on it. Meaning, now we knew that IVIG has a selective effect on cytokine balance. That led us to study the effect of IVIG on the TH1, TH2 equilibrium or balance. We know that in a disease called EAE, which is a model for multiple sclerosis, the TH1 guys are the bad guys. They are the one which are pro-inflammatory. And in this animal model, if you inject IVIG, just like in human beings, it can control the disease. What we showed was that this is also associated with the regulation of the pro-inflammatory cytokines and readjusting the balance towards anti-inflammatory or non-inflammatory profile. So we knew that there was one more mechanism by which IVIG can control inflammation. What I was trying to tell you earlier about the Fc receptor is that these Fc receptors, this Fc portion of immunoglobulin, can interact with Fc receptors, and there are a range of different Fc receptors. Most Fc receptors, like the Fc gamma R1, R2A, R3A, or R3B, or even R4, are pro-inflammatory, or actually they stimulate the immune system. They are present on a range of cells, as you can see. They are involved in either phagocytosis or antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity, phagocytosis or platelet aggregation, or induction of the killing of the target cell by NK cells. That is the role of many of these Fc receptors. But then, curiously, there is one set of Fc receptor called Fc gamma R2B. This particular Fc gamma R2B or CD32, by virtue of expressing ITIM, meaning immunoreceptor tyrosine-based inhibition motif, it can switch off the inflammation induced by these other cytokines. In other words, whenever there is an excess of inflammation, these Fc gamma R2Bs are engaged or upregulated. And when these are upregulated, inflammation is brought under control. This is important. Keep in mind, I may mention that in a few minutes. Because in Rockefeller, Jeffrey Ravitch demonstrated was that IVIG actually can upregulate Fc gamma R2b, and it can inhibit the stimulation induced by other cytokines. Very beautiful finding. But meanwhile, along with Jagdish Bairi, who is now the professor of biotechnology in IIT Palakkad, he has gone back to India. He has been my colleague for the last 20 odd years. What with Jagdish, what we looked at was the role of immunoglobulins on dendritic cells. You have heard about the dendritic cells a few minutes ago. And the dendritic cells are extremely important. They stand at the center of regulating the immune response. Either they can polarize the T cells towards TH1, TH17, TH2, or Tregs, or they can induce immunoregulatory functions on the B cells. So having an effect on the dendritic cell function is very important. So what Jagdish demonstrated was that IVIG can actually block the differentiation, the maturation, and function of dendritic cells. This was a very beautiful finding, not just because it gave us a few papers, but it gave us some ideas about what else can happen. Because this, when you block the differentiation function and maturation and function, you actually impart a tolerogenic phenotype to the dendritic cells. You impart a tolerogenic phenotype to the dendritic cells. In other words, tolerogenic dendritic cells are very crucial in maintaining a non-inflammatory status, and that happens through regulatory T cells. This bunch of regulatory T cells that you already heard about is very interesting population of T cells, because these regulatory T cells can control the TH17 cells. Why is it important? Because over the last 15, 20 years, we and others, Vijay Kochhru, for example, in the United States, and many other groups have demonstrated the role of TH17 or IL-17 or TH17 subgroup in a large number of autoimmune and inflammatory diseases. What we did, particularly Shiva Shankar Othi, who is now in UC Irvine, he demonstrated that in patients that are suffering from Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is a neuromuscular disorder, neuroimmunological disorder, where there is excessive production of IL-17 through TH17, what we demonstrated was there is an upregulation of regulatory T cells and concurrent downregulation of TH17. The underlying mechanisms involved in this upregulation of regulatory T cells by IVIG is fascinating. And what are the molecular mechanisms that are involved, and how in the past we demonstrated the TH1, TH2 balance, and now we demonstrated that IVIG can actually upregulate the Tregs and downregulate the TH17 cells, and the mechanisms underlying is a fascinating area of research. But since I don't have a lot of time, I will skip that part, but I'll take questions. What, in brief, we have now demonstrated, or I have demonstrated to you this afternoon or this evening to you, is that antibodies within IVIG that we call as natural antibodies. Why natural? Because you and me and most of the individuals, all of us sitting here, healthy individuals have antibodies. Healthy individuals have antibodies that are natural because they are not necessarily induced by a pathogen, at least not overtly pathogen induced. So we all have natural antibodies in our circulation, and that is exactly what is the composition of IVIG. And what we demonstrated to you over the last few minutes is that on one hand, these natural antibodies that are present in the pool of normal immunoglobulins called IVIG exert potent antimicrobial effect agent, and that's why they're efficient in immunodeficiencies. Incidentally, most immunodeficient patients survive on IVIG. Every 3 to 4 weeks, these patients get immunoglobulins, and they can lead practically a normal life, which would not have been possible if you don't, we would not have discovered the role of antibodies as antimicrobial agents. But what we also demonstrated to you today is that they are not only, I mean, these antibodies are not only antimicrobial agents, but they are also strong immunoregulators. They can tweak the immune system even in autoimmunity or in inflammatory conditions and bring back the normalcy or bring back a homeostasis. This to me is fascinating, how the very normal immunoglobulins, which we thought were only responsible for neutralizing the pathogens, exert such fantastic immunoregulatory functions. And the last word is not said yet. We still are in the process of discovering many, many interesting functions of natural antibodies. So to close, the way I look at an immune system in a very naive or a simple-minded manner is like this. On a perfect day in Pune for Padma and for Arvind, or in Bangalore or elsewhere, this is how the immune system looks like. No terrorism, no bioterrorism, no tsunami, no other problems. Let's hope no corona either. Everybody is perfect. Everybody is normal. And this is how the normal immune system looks like to me. But unfortunately, if there is an unusual activity of one clone or one cell or one molecule of the immune system, either defective or deviated or abnormal behavior, soon this abnormal behavior spreads around. Immune system becomes berserk. It gets out of control. We know that an inflammation is a generalized condition. We know that most autoimmune diseases are generalized conditions. Even if it is an organ specific, there is a general disturbance in the architecture and the dynamics of the immune system. What we want to do to correct such immune dysfunction is not by suppressing the immune system. Chandrasekhar was mentioning earlier about corticosteroids or immunosuppressants. While it is important to control the immune system abnormality, for me, what is important is to maintain the normal function of the immune system, normal homeostasis of the immune system. And to do so, I would like to use something like IVIG. By virtue of the variable regions or the diversity of antibodies that come from several thousand healthy people, these normal immunoglobulins carry the potential of physiological repertoire. They bring in the normal physiological repertoire because they contain more than 10 to the 16 antibody specificities, and they re-establish the homeostasis. To me, this is what the way I would like to look at immunotherapy, not just suppression, but to re-establish the immune homeostasis. I thank you very much, and I thank all my colleagues. I mentioned some of them, Shiva, Pushpa, Sebastian, Justa, Ankit, and then my bald head here, Jagdish is bald head. You don't have to be bald to come to my lab, but if you are, it helps. And all my colleagues here. Mohan was involved in the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine program, by the way. He's in Pfizer in United States, and he was in the team of the Pfizer vaccine. Proud of him. Thank you very much, people, and over to you.
Dr. Chandrasekhar, a lot of questions in the chat box I've pasted.
Okay. First of all, Dr. Srini, it has been a wonderful, wonderful talk. You have given us a wonderful story, which is a century old story, getting us different characters at different time and telling us the role of each one of them and how they were discovered, and a beautiful, beautiful story. I don't think today anybody who's participating in this program would regret having gone for not having gone for a movie or having a better time. I think today immunology series and what the story that you have told has made us feel that we have been happy listening to these lectures than going out. We have a few questions. Let us take a few of them. There is one person, Khushbu. Okay, there is some Rajeshwari Parida. She says, I want to know about the immunomodulatory action of immunoglobulins during IVIG therapies. Does it in our serious side effects? Thank you. She says
this. A very good question. immunoregulatory or immunomodulatory function of IVIG, as I mentioned, has a variety of effects on different components of the immune system. And depending on the pathology and depending on the window in which you treat, you would have probably a differential effect. But her main question is whether there are any major adverse effects or serious side effects. As of now, the adverse effects that are observed with IVIG are very limited. There is nausea, headache, chills for a few days, but not necessarily in all patients. As I mentioned, in immunodeficiency, these patients, they live all their lives with IVIG. They would not have any major or at least serious side effects. When there are side effects, there are other reasons, but then I'll not go into the details, because if you have antibodies against A system, there are other IgA, et cetera, but we will not go to the answer to your question. There are no major serious side effects.
Okay, we have a next question from Khushbu Priya. She says, yeah. Good evening. My question is, do we know what is the balance of range in which the Tregs and the Th17 should be there to prevent an organism from moving towards autoimmunity?
Yeah, it's interesting question. You see, let us take the example of multiple sclerosis, or in an animal model, let us take the example of EAE, experimental autoimmune encephalomyelitis. We know that there is a certain level of IL-17 that is secreted, which is extremely potent pro-inflammatory. But then you cannot say, okay, to such an extent it is good and such an extent it is not good. What we need to know is a correlation with the pathology induced by these cytokines. And if you can suppress that and then bring back to the normal level using IVIG, and then that is concurrently upregulating the regulatory T cells, that's good enough. You don't have to know exactly, because each individual varies and it depends on the individuals. Some would have a very severe reaction, even with a small amount of cytokines, others would not. So instead of quantifying, yes, there is, we know the moment compared to his pre-inflammatory status, if there is an excess of inflammation because of these cytokines or because of the subgroup of cells, you need to do them. So it depends on the individuals. Then you have...
There is one more question. What would be the mechanism route by which IVIG take to enter inner regions of an organ or a tissue, more particularly an immunological privileged site, to render the therapeutic effect?
Yeah, I know why Sethu Swaminathan is asking me. He wants to know how IVIG would be effective in ophthalmology, for example, or autoimmune uveitis. Yeah, I guess that's his question. Yes, there are a few interesting studies where birdshot retinopathy or autoimmune uveitis have been treated with IVIG. And we do not know exactly whether the IVIG is or has to be present locally at the site to exert its effect. But there are some observations that there are present. But more importantly to me, even exerting an effect through outside, meaning there's a particular word I forget, at distance, you can even correct some of the organ specific or remote organs such as eyes. But then I would be a bit careful, because IVIG in ophthalmology or in autoimmune uveitis, I would be a bit careful before I make any conclusion. But this is an interesting question, and we have not fully dissected how, whether or not IVIG reaches the target organ to exert its effect. Or, for example, in EAE, although the effect is at the central nervous system, we know that by siphoning out the bad cells from there, it can exert from outside. If I understand, if I try to answer, so we can discuss this, Sethu, some other time also. But it's a good question. Yeah.
Krishini, I have a question.
Please,
in the present scenario of COVID-19 infection, there's so much of talk.
Yeah.
What is the role for immunoglobulins? Maybe asymptomatic, and there be there the cytokine storm or whatever you call it. Could there be any role for it?
We just got a paper accepted it's a very beautiful compilation, two or three papers on. There are many groups in China, in Northern European countries, and one or two from the United States and here, on the possible use of IVIG coronavirus infection. And there are different ways, when you consider antibodies, there are different ways of looking at the beneficial effect of antibodies. Let's see antibodies. I'll be very brief, Chandra. I will not take more time. On one hand, you have convalescent plasma. This is beautiful because all that we learned in the last century is how to use the convalescent plasma. The veterinarians know how to use it. If there is one herd that is affected by one disease, infectious diseases, they will not allow that, you know, the next village is stopped. I mean, the spread of the infection because they get the plasma from here, the convalescent plasma, they inject into the animals on the next herd. This is one answer. Secondly, IVIG has a very strong effect on the cytokine burst. As Chandra mentioned, at one particular phase, when the immune system goes out of control, when the virus is multiplying, one cell can have 1,000 copies in 16 hours of coronavirus. And that triggers the cytokine burst. And more cytokines are coming, more and more viruses. And so there is an absolutely chaotic situation. And therefore, at one particular time, not in all patients, there is a beneficial effect of IVIG. But then I'm not paid by any company to sell IVIG, so I'm not going to say more about that.
Okay, I think we will once again thank Dr. Kaveri for the wonderful, wonderful lecture. And we enjoy, I'm sure all of them will share.